Hi, this is Dr. Claire, and this is the first of our lectures on animals. So we're moving on from the plant and fungus section of the course to the animal part of the course. And our first lecture here is on the nervous system. And this is something that is pretty unique to the animals. No plants or fungus or protists have nervous systems. And what a nervous system does is it allows the animal to react very rapidly to their environment. So it allows them to respond to environmental stimuli and in many cases move and do other animal-like things like moving around. So all animals, with the exception of sponges, have some sort of nervous system. And we're gonna be coming back to sponges again because sponges are weird. So a lot of times we'll be talking about animals in general and there's gonna be some exception and that exception is going to be sponges. But all other animals have some sort of network of nerves that can transport signals around the body and allow different parts of the body to communicate with each other very, very rapidly. So if you look at the diversity of nervous systems that are present, there are some different ways that nervous systems can be set up. Many animals have a centralized area where the nervous system is concentrated. This is usually in the head of the animal. And having that centralized area where the nervous system and sensory systems are concentrated is called cephalization. So if you look at vertebrates, for example, any vertebrate has a distinct cephalization where there's the brain and most of the sensory organs are actually concentrated in the head region. But not all animals have that. If you look at something like a cnidarian or other animals in the cnidaria, which is the group that includes jellyfish and corals and sea anemones, those have what's called a nerve net. So they have interconnected nerves, but they don't have a centralized nervous system. Other things like echinoderms, they have a central ring in the middle of the echinoderm and then branching patterns that radiate out. But many other species like arthropods and mollusks do have this centralized head region that's similar to the vertebrates. So if you're looking at these nerves that make up the nervous system, nearly all nerves have the same basic structure. So they have a cell body. That's the main bulky part of the nerve. That's where the nucleus is going to be contained and your various other cellular structures are going to be contained in that nucleus. And then branching off from the cell body, you have dendrites. And dendrites receive signals from other cells. And they tend to be relatively short. And then you have an axon, and the axon sends the signal from that nerve to other nerves or to other cells, such as muscle cells. Okay, so all nerves are directional, so information comes in through the dendrites, passes through the cell body, and goes out the axon and on to other cells at the end. Okay, so we're always going dendrites to axon, so it's a very directional process. Okay. The axon is very important because that's going to be, they're often quite long and they need to be protected, and that's going to be how the nerve sends the signal on to other cells in the body. And so the axon is actually protected by a number of cells called neuroglial cells. And these cells basically wrap around, they form what's called a myelin sheath around that axon. Myelin is a protein. And that what that does is it insulates the axon and keeps the signal the axon is sending close to the cell and protects it from any damage. So if you think about a nerve as being analogous to a power cord going, say, to your cell phone, that power cord is sending electricity from your wall to your cell phones, and that electricity is like the signal in the nerve cell. And in order for that electricity to make it, it has to be insulated. So you have that plastic case that goes around the cord, around the wires itself. Then the wires are doing the transmitting, but that plastic wrapping around the wires protects the signal and keeps it from going out into other places like your hand, which would be rather unpleasant. So it's a similar type of thing. The myelin sheath around the axons keeps the signal inside the axon and keeps it traveling down. Down the axon to the next cell. Now there's three different major types of neurons. There are sensory neurons. Sensory neurons pick up signals from sensory cells, and we'll talk more about the sensory system in the next lecture. But the sensory nerves pick up signals and detect stimuli from the sensory cells and then pass that information to the central nervous system for interpretation. Okay? Then you also have motor neurons. Motor neurons take information from the central nervous system and send signals out to the various cells to cause effects. So for example, if you want to flex your arm, your motor neurons are going from your brain is going flex arm, and it sends a signal, and then the motor neurons deliver that signal to your muscles to flex your arm, okay? And then there are interneurons, and interneurons connect one neuron to another. They tend to be associated with reflexes and memory and language, so most of the brain is made up of these interneurons with very complex interactions that are, or connections that are interacting with each other that allow you to do very complex things with that neural system in your brain. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about how signals are passed along the neurons. Your book goes into a lot more detail on this, but again, because we really haven't covered cellular biology very much here, we're going to kind of simplify it a little bit and make it a little less complicated. Basically, when you're looking at a neuron, the neuron has a charge across the cell membrane. So the outside the cell is positively charged, inside the cell is negatively charged. Because there's that difference in the charge, we call it a polarized cell. Okay, so it's got positive charge outside, negative charge inside. And that those charges are determined by differences in concentrations of particular ions, and particular things like sodium and potassium. Okay, so when the neuron is stimulated, what happens is the polarization changes. So the cell becomes what we call depolarized. So the positive ions flow into the cell, and so then you have a negative charge outside the cell and a positive charge inside the cell. Then very, very quickly, positive ions are then pumped back out of the cell, restoring the polarization, and that switch happens very, very rapidly. So it can happen in about a millisecond, okay? So about a thousandth of a second. And then when one section of the cell becomes polarized, that triggers the next chunk of the cell down to become polarized. So a signal can be passed down the length of the cell through this inversion of the charge across the membrane, okay? And so that's how the signals are transmitted down the neuron, all right? So you can send a signal from your brain to your toe in a few hundredths of a second, which is pretty impressive, okay? That makes sense? I'm also going to post a video link to another video that I think illustrates this pretty well, so take a look at that as well. All right, so then you get to the end of your neuron. So how do you get a signal from one neuron to another? Well, once you get to the end of the neuron, that depolarization that occurs stimulates the release of neurotransmitters into what's called the synaptic cleft. So you have an end of one neuron. So at the end of the axon, you have these synapses, and the synapse from one neuron is going to be touching the next neuron down. But there's like a little gap there. There's a little bit of space between the synapse. That's the synaptic cleft. So a neurotransmitter will be released from this neuron. It'll move across that synaptic cleft and stimulate the cells on the next cell down to depolarize. So it'll stimulate that change in charge across the cell membrane in the next cell, and then that signal can then propagate down the neuron. Okay? All right, so if we're looking at the nervous system, particularly if we're looking at the nervous system in a vertebrate, so in something that's got a spine, you can divide the nervous system into two major chunks. You have the central nervous system. The central nervous system includes the brain and the spinal cord, and then the peripheral nervous system. The peripheral nervous system is all of the other nerves in the body that are sending signals to the extremities. And among the peripheral nervous system, you have two subcategories. You have the somatic nervous system, which is under conscious control. So that's when you think about something and send a signal to your body to do that particular thing. And then you have the autonomic nervous system, which is not under your conscious control. It's still under the control of the central nervous system, but it is not under your conscious control. So these are like the signals that make your heart beat, that can stimulate your glands, various things like that. Stimulate smooth muscle in your intestine. All of these different things are not under your conscious control, but still under the control of your nervous system. All right. So the central nervous system is largely responsible for data processing, decision making, that kind of more complex stuff, although there are some reflexes within the central nervous system as well. The peripheral nervous system is largely responsible for receiving and sending signals to various extremities within the body. So all your sensory neurons and your motor neurons are going to be located in your peripheral nervous system. So let's take a closer look at the spinal cord in particular. Spinal cord is part of the central nervous system. It's like the information superhighway. It's sending information from the brain to the rest of the body down the spine. It's enclosed within your vertebral column because it's really, really important. If the spinal cord gets severed, then the rest of your body is going to be cut off from signals to your brain. And that is really bad. So if you have a spinal cord severing in the neck, then no signals from your brain will get to any part of your body, and that can be fatal because you need signals from your brain to regulate things like your breathing and your heart rate and things that you need to keep you alive. So the spinal cord is really important, which is why it's encased in that vertebral column in the bone where it's going to be safer. It also functions in terms of reflexes. So there are some decisions that are actually made by your spinal cord, not by your brain. So one example of that is the kick reflex, or the knee-jerk reflex. If you've ever gone to the doctor and they hit you in the knee with a little rubber hammer and then your leg goes bloop and it kicks, right? Well, what's going on there is that you have a sensory neuron in your thigh. When you hit the tendon in your knee, it stretches that sensory neuron. That sends a signal to your spinal cord, and the spinal cord's response is to send a signal down a motor neuron that causes your thigh muscle to contract. Now, why would you want to do that? Well, turns out that when you are walking, your thigh muscles are constantly stretching and contracting, and so not having to have that signal go all the way up to the brain for a response allows us to walk on two legs. So we can react very quickly to whatever information we're getting while walking from our legs, and then respond appropriately in order to stay on our feet. I want to say a little bit more about the peripheral nervous system. So the peripheral nervous system is largely made up of nerves. So nerves are just bundles of the axons of neurons. So you can have these kind of visible nerve fibers that are a whole bunch of neurons all bundled together. And also ganglia. Ganglia, which is the plural of ganglion, in case you wanted to know. Ganglia are groups of cell bodies of neurons, all right? So you've got both of those in your peripheral nervous system. And the main purpose of the peripheral nervous system, of course, is to gather information from your environment and send information to your body. So when you're looking at the peripheral nervous system, you can kind of break it down into two major parts. I talked about this a minute ago. You've got your somatic nervous system. That's the part that's under your conscious control, and your autonomic nervous system, which is under your unconscious control. And then the autonomic is further divided into two categories, the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. And you can kind of think of these, the sympathetic controls fight or flight responses. So your sympathetic nervous system controls reactions to stress. Your parasympathetic is the rest and digest nervous system. So it controls responses when you are not under stress, when you're at rest. So if you look at the breakdown for that, you can see that there are kind of contrasting functions of the sympathetic and the parasympathetic. So for example, when the sympathetic is stimulated, things happen like your eyes dilate to take in more information, your heart rate increases, your breathing rate increases, you secrete adrenaline from your adrenal gland, your stomach becomes less active, your mouth becomes very dry, and all of these are responses to stress. So your body is preparing to deal with whatever stressful situation you're in. If you're in a life or death situation, you're not worried about eating right now. So you don't have to worry about producing saliva. You don't have to worry about your stomach digesting things. You just need to get through the situation. So you need to take in more information by dilating your eyes. You need to be ready to run or fight. So you need more oxygen to get to all your muscles, so your heart rate and your breathing rate increases, and you're ready to deal with the situation. Now that's good. It allows you to deal with that situation at the time being, and then when the risk has passed, the parasympathetic kicks on, your eyes constrict, you produce saliva, your food digests, your heart rate slows, your breathing rate slows, you go to the bathroom, all of that fun stuff, right? And that's what you need to do to keep alive for the long term. But when you're under a very extremely stressful situation, the sympathetic nervous system will turn that all off so that you can deal with that stress, and then the parasympathetic will bring it back online once the stress has passed. Now, of course, in the modern situation, your body overreacts to perceived stressors. For example, public speaking. You're not actually going to die from public speaking, but your body acts like you really need to deal with a very stressful situation. Your mouth gets dry, you get very anxious, your heart pounds, you breathe fast, your hands shake, and this is all your body reacting to the perceived threat of having to speak in front of people. Okay? That's it for the nervous system. Catch you guys next time.